Good morning.
Good morning.
Just want to bring some things to our attention as we begin today. We want to continue to pray for a number of different people. I'll mention them in our prayer who just kind of the continual needs there. One added prayer need is Dick Lancer has back trouble and was in a lot of pain today. So Judy was here for the first service but wanted prayer for Dick. And I pray also for Pastor JJ trying to take some vacation time this week, so that pray for that also. A few announcements. Our online service is at 6:30. Our read through the Bible, there will be no focus, but the read through the Bible will be at 10:30 on Friday. We have our Christmas Eve service, and I want to mention for both Christmas Eve service and next week, so next week is Christmas Sunday, I'm going to be presenting the gospel in both of those, and Pastor JJ might do it on Christmas Eve also. So we're saying this is really friendly to people who don't know the gospel or haven't received Christ. So we want to really encourage, if you know somebody or have a family member who you're not sure if they're truly born again, this will be an excellent opportunity for Christmas Eve, which is a Friday this year, and then and that'll be at 6:30. And then also next week, can you imagine, next week is Christmas Sunday? Wow, comes quickly. And then I will be doing two Christmas messages, since the next message will be on the 26th. So we'll be kind of splitting the text on John chapter 1. The other thing we want to mention is that ordination service for Pastor JJ was scheduled for today, and we just weren't able to get everything together on time. So we're moving it to hopefully January 23rd. But we want to also say congratulations to Pastor JJ. He has passed everything, so it has gone on. It has gone on to the higher ups in the Evangelical Free Church, and they've had their readers, and the readers have done that, and it's all come back approved. So now all we have to do is have the service. So we hope to have that on January 23rd. We're still waiting on one individual to get back to us, and I know we were hoping Randy could be there, and he's going to be away. So we're still working on some of the details as it relates to that. But January 23rd is the expected time. At this time, let's worship the Lord together.
Nature.
To this Christmas time, I was thinking of two really key ingredients that are the biblical spirit of Christmas. And it's interesting because Pastor JJ and I did not coordinate this with the first two songs, but the first song was Joy to the World, and the second one was Glory to the Highest. And the text I'm going to read really covers both of those thoughts. It comes from Luke chapter 2, verse 10 and 14. I bring you good tidings of what? Great joy. And then in verse 14, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. And those two ingredients that we see consistently in the picture of the Christmas season is joy, the joy of the Lord, because Jesus has come, and then the peace of God that comes. And you know, we all often hear, you know, what is the Christmas spirit? And we think of, you know, gift giving and things like that. But truly, if you have joy and peace,
amen,
that's the Christmas spirit. And that's what we should really look to have, not just on a temporary come and go basis, because a lot of joy and peace kind of comes and goes, doesn't it? But not this kind of joy, not this kind of peace. This is that which remains. And so I just thought we want to bring that thought to you as we continue to celebrate Christmas together. There is a basket in the back for our tithes and offerings as part of our worship today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, just thank you so much. So much for the joy and peace that comes as a result of Jesus coming to earth and dying for our sins and bringing forth the gospel and the hope of the resurrection. We're just so grateful that in this season, as we remember him coming to earth, that we can remind ourselves of that spirit of joy and peace that comes through Jesus Christ our Lord. Father, we also want to thank you that we have the opportunity to give back and to worship you in our tithes and offerings. We pray that the tithes and offerings would be bring honor and glory to your name and would be used to serve for your glory and your praise. We also, Lord, want to bring the many needs before you that are in the church. We continue to pray for Judy. We pray that you would continue to heal her more fully from the COVID, as it's been a rough ride for her. We pray also for Patty and her broken arm, and pray for continual healing. We pray for Bea and Peter, and just pray for your grace to mediate in that situation. We pray for many others that I know are in need, and we just lift them up and commit them to you. We lift up very specifically today Dick and his back and the difficulty he's having and the pain he's having even at this very moment today. We pray for relief. We pray for your grace to really minister to Dick and also to Judy during this time of significant pain in Dick's back. And we thank you now that we can come and continue to pick up that theme of worship in Christmas. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah. Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. All right, Luke chapter 12. We've been doing a series in Luke chapter 12, and today we're going to be looking specifically at verse 4. Want to make mention just kind of where we've gone through. There's a huge crowd coming to see Jesus to the point where they're stepping on one another. And Jesus, in the midst of this crowd, turns to the disciples and says to them, first of all, and he says, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. He goes on to talk about that nothing covered up will not be revealed, and pretty much says that four times in four different ways. And that leads us to our verse today in verse 4. And really the conclusion of what we're saying in verse 4 comes in verse 5. So I want to read today verse 4 and 5, but today we're going to be looking at verse 4. Jesus said, I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body, and after that, no more that they can do. But I will warn you whom to fear. Fear the one who after he has killed has authority to cast into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. Let's pray. Father, I pray that as we come and look at this text today, and as we consider the temporal body that we have, Lord, I pray that you would help us to look toward the eternal, to the things that will truly last. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In life, we experience death. Lots of different kinds of death. Maybe you have someone that you really cared about that has passed away. Someone that you love very dearly. But death even follows us, even in some of the more other things, whether it's a pet. Maybe have you ever had a family pet that you had for a long time and your pet passed away? I remember there was this one point in time when I was at Grace up in Western New York. The other pastors that were there thought it was funny for some reason, I don't know why, but thought it was funny that I didn't really want to have any pets. And so one year as a joke, they got me a little betta fish for Christmas or something like that. They put it on my dress and my desk there. And I was like, I don't know what to do with the betta fish here. What am I supposed to do? So I tried. I really, believe me, I don't love animals as pets for myself, but I tried with this little fish, but lo and behold, a couple months later, what do you think happened? This fish died, right? And I promise you I tried, but I'll tell you, it's amazing how things are very fragile like that. And even this little fish can die, and I tried, I fed it, you know, I did everything I could, and they were like, hey, it's just going to sit in the little bowl. You don't even have to do anything to the water or anything, and I don't know, maybe that was wrong. But either way, whether it was me that killed it or just died on its own, it died. You know, things die. It's because it's temporal. And we need to keep that in mind as we come to our text today. Now, we do assume that what we see here is that Jesus is talking still to his disciples. We see that from verse 1, where he's talking to them first of all. And the assumption is that he is continuing to talk to the disciples here. Jesus knows what is going to happen, first of all, to his own body. People are going to kill him. He is going to experience bodily death. Jesus knows that. He knows also that his disciples will also die martyrs' deaths. And Jameson Fawcett Brown says this, Jesus calls his disciples my friends, as if he had felt that such sufferings constituted a bond of particular tenderness between him and them. In other words, what Jameson Fawcett Brown is really trying to say is, my friends, don't be afraid of those that are going to kill us. Jesus says this as a source of comfort and care for them. There is nothing more that their persecutors can do than to kill the body. Guzik says it this way. He says, it is reasonable to think that the disciples felt the increasing stress and anxiety leading up to the crucifixion. They needed to gain the same peace Jesus had and put fear into perspective. And I believe that what Jesus is doing here is to remind them of something important. You are not just your body. Yes, men can kill the body, but that's all they can do. There's more to you than just your body. Yes, this body is temporal. And yes, men can do awful things to us in our mortal bodies. But if you are secure in who you are in Christ, this is something you can know. They can't destroy anymore. There's so much that does happen in this world that is awful. I'm not trying to deny that. Men can be very evil, and there's lots of awful things that can happen. But I will say this, if we only have a temporal perspective, then wouldn't we be pretty much without hope completely? We have something greater that we can hold on to. Clark says this about persecution. He says, those who slay with acts of cruelty, alluding probably to the cruelties which persecutors would exercise on his followers in their martyrdom. And the fact of the matter is, the disciples died brutal deaths. History tells us that all of them died a martyr's death, aside from John, who was exiled to the island of Patmos. And Jesus, as we know, died a brutal death. And the temporal perspective will never be able to give meaning and hope to this evil world. Let me say that again. A temporal perspective will never be able to bring hope in this evil world. The hope is that it will not always be like this. The hope that we have is that God, we will be with him forever and ever. There's lots of questions people have in our world today. Many Christians struggle with questions, as well as non-believers, that they even see these questions as stumbling blocks to faith in Christ. Why does God allow evil? Well, why does God allow death? Why does God allow pain? If he's powerful enough, why doesn't he stop these things? If he's loving, why wouldn't he prevent these things from happening altogether? And from a temporal perspective, you can understand why these things would really trip people up. If God has power, why doesn't he stop these things? But we're more than temporal, aren't we? God has eternity in perspective. That doesn't mean that we'll always know why. Why does God allow these things? There's lots of reasons that we don't know. We're not aware of. We're not God. We don't see things the way God sees them. But Jesus' point to his disciples right now is, don't be afraid of them. We do not need to fear what man can do to us. Knowing this, I want to propose to you, God may not stop tragic things. God may not allow, or God may allow difficult things to happen in our lives. I'm not going to deny that. And we may ask the question, why God? And by the way, I think God welcomes you to ask that question, you know? But I know this. If our reaction is, I have to push God away because that hurts, or because I don't like that, then you're pushing away the one person that gives meaning to suffering.
That's right.
Jeff Black, one of my professors, one of Dad's co-workers, he once said, and it'll always stick with me, God is not a God who takes away your pain, but God is a God who walks with you in the midst of your pain. I don't think the point is that God will take it away or not take it away. The point is that God is with you in the midst of your pain.
Amen.
God brings meaning to pain. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. warms us with a beautiful promise. He causes all things to work together for good to those that love him and who are called according to his purpose. I can't answer all the whys. I don't know the whys. And you know what? God hasn't chosen to reveal to you all the whys either. But what I can say is he promises that he will cause it to work together for good. So love him and walk according to his purpose. This is a really hard sermon for me to give right now. We were expecting another little one in July. And we found out on Thursday there was no heartbeat for the baby. And it's just kind of hit us a lot that we were really excited. We told our kids. It's really hard telling our kids what's going on. I've had a really hard time putting together the sermon because of it, as you can imagine, as we're talking about, you know, the body. I will never get to hold that little baby. I will never get to hear the little baby's cry. I'll never get to see that baby grow up. Know that that baby is with Jesus. I'm so glad that that little baby was more than just a body. Because though that body, that baby's body is not alive, that baby is with Jesus and has a real life. And today, of all days, trying to preach on the temporal versus the eternal, I need to cling to the eternal perspective today. That we are more than just a body. I believe that life begins at conception. I believe that. And I don't mean to make things political if you disagree with me on something, but I believe that that's what Scripture teaches. And because of that, this little baby had a soul. And even though that baby's body is no longer functioning and the heart is no longer beating, that baby is with Christ. Some might debate on that too. How do you know that? The scripture I would cite is when David was aware that his baby was going to die and ultimately did die. He gets up and he stops fasting and the people say, well, why are you fasting? He said, you know, ultimately what he says is, that baby can't come to me anymore, but I can go to him. And that's the scripture that we would use for that concept. I share this all with you because I think it's so crucial for me right now. I feel it. I don't know if you feel it, but I feel it. We need to have an eternal perspective. And with that in mind, I'd love for us, if you're willing, to turn to 1 Corinthians 4, verse 17. 2 Corinthians 4, 17. I have it wrong in my notes. I said, forget that was. Second Corinthians 4. Dad and I have both mentioned the scripture. Dad has mentioned it much in the past. And I remember even probably as a teen, you talking about this scripture. But I wanted to point it out today as I needed this today. And I hope it would be encouraging for you. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17, Paul says, "For momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comprehension." And what I wanted to do is just to take a moment to understand what Paul's doing there. I'm not sure how it is in your other translations, but in the New American, it's very clear. Momentary light affliction in comparison with the eternal weight of glory. And this is an amazing thing to really look at when it comes to this, this idea of momentary being contrasted with eternity. Momentary versus eternity. This idea of something that is light versus that which is eternal, forever. An affliction versus the idea of glory. This is the contrast that Paul is bringing to us today. Momentary light affliction. And when it comes to the situation that I'm sharing with you, and as I come to just some thoughts for us to remember today, this, I needed this in my prep work. Remember to compare the temporal versus the eternal. The first point that I have is suffering is momentary versus that which is eternal. What I don't think it means, and what I don't think I'm trying to say, is that it feels temporary or it feels momentary. I don't think that's really the point of what Paul's trying to say. I don't think he's trying to say it feels like it's, you know, hey, we can all be happy now because it's just momentary anyway, no big deal. I don't think that's Paul's point. I think his point is to compare these moments that we have on this earth and the suffering that we go through in comparison to what is forever. And when we look at today, it's not that our suffering doesn't hurt. Guys, I'm hurting today. My wife is hurting today. My kids are hurting today. And I'm not trying to lighten that and make it sound like, oh, it's no big deal, it's momentary anyway. It's a big deal to us today. I'm very glad that I can look forward to eternity in the midst of our grieving, right? I'm very thankful that I can know of eternity. Secondly, remember to compare the temporal versus the eternal. Suffering is light versus the weight of eternity. Now, when I say this, I don't think, again, as I'm making mention, I don't think what Paul's saying is that whatever you're suffering with is no big deal. It's whatever. You know, just smile about it. Laugh. It's fine. You know? I don't think that's Paul's point. I think his point is that when you compare the incredible weight of eternity to the very real suffering that's momentary, there's a big difference. And the weight of eternity is so that much greater than the difficult suffering that we go through today. Finally, remember to compare the temporal versus the eternal, suffering and affliction. Notice that it talks about that. It's not saying, oh, your affliction is light. It's talking about something deep and the difficulties that we go through, and is comparing glory forever when things are made right. And I'll just be honest, in this moment, as we're dealing with what we're dealing with, I need to be reminded of our eternal hope in the midst of my grief. I'm not belittling my grief. I'm not belittling what I'm feeling. I'm not feeling great. My wife isn't either. But we can have hope in the midst of our grief. Second point I want to look at in regards to our text is that they can kill the body, but there's no more that they can do. Look at what it says in verse 4. Jesus says, I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who can kill the body, and after that, have no more that they can do. So that's what we're going to be looking at next. Now, you might say, hey, Jay, you know, I know you're talking about some things that are real personal, but the context is really about persecution. It's not about the situation. And I understand that, but I'm just being honest with how this struck me as I'm dealing with my own stuff. In regards to that aspect of what can man do, though, it is important to think through. As humans, we are made up of more than just a body. And yes, people can kill a body, but they can't kill every part of a person. Now, I would argue, from my position, I would be what's called a trichotomist. versus someone who might be a dichotomist. A trichotomist believes that we're made up of body, soul, and spirit. So three different parts. The dichotomist usually lumps soul and spirit as one thing. But I get that idea from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, which uses body, soul, and spirit within the context there. And I just want to say this. We are more than our physical body. We're more than that. And praise the Lord, because these bodies are not that great anyway, right? We're more than that. And because of that, we can trust in a God who handles the soul. Now, in the next scripture, the next verse, it talks about how God is the one who's in control of the one who can throw into hell. That's referring to our soul or spirit, however you want to see that. And the fact of the matter is that we are more than just the body. The spirit and the soul are eternal. Now, we will have resurrected bodies as well. But right now, if someone dies, their body is going to be rotting and decaying. My mom passed away. Her body is long rotted, I'm sure. But her spirit, her soul, is with Jesus. She is not in the ground in her spirit and in her soul. But there's to be clear, there's no one on this earth that can do a lick right now to her soul, right? There's nothing anyone here can do in regards to my mom's soul, who passed away in 2007. Nothing that we can do. So when it comes to this idea of what can man do? Man can kill the body. By the way, the body's temporal already. So even if they kill something that's temporal, it was already temporal anyway. You're going to die at some point in time anyway, right? So the point is that only man can impact that which is temporal. God is the one in charge of the eternal. Clark says this, hence we find that the body and the soul are distinct principles. For the body may be slain and the soul escape. And secondly, that the soul is immaterial, for the murderers of the body have it not in their power to injure it. Man has no power. And as we'll see, like I said in the next verse, we'll look at God who deals with the soul. You know, man can't do anything more than kill the temporal body that will die anyway. Guzik says this, he says, all persecutors can do is kill, and God has the ultimate power over life and death of the believer. Therefore, we shouldn't fear our persecutors, but have a healthy respect of God that makes us more concerned with obeying him than any man. We don't need to fear what man can do. They have no real lasting impact. God is bigger than all those things. Now, I don't know your stories, all of them, and what you've experienced in your life. Maybe there's been someone that has done something just truly awful to you, and it's impacted your whole life. And listen, there are real hurts, and I'm not trying to minimize real hurts. They're real for us. But I also want us to come to the hope that we have, because man can hurt. But God brings healing. God will restore. God will bring joy. As Revelation tells us, he will wipe away every tear. There'll be no more sorrow, no more pain, no more. Now, I'm not saying that means that your grief in the moment isn't anything important. You still need to wrestle with the hurts and the pains, as today I am. They're real, and they're not minimized. But we have hope in the midst of our sorrow. Not trying to be light about the evil of man, but what I am wanting to do is hold high in regard the power of God despite man's sin. Clark says this, he says, a man has but one life to lose and one soul to save, and it is madness to sacrifice the salvation of the soul to the preservation of the life, or as I would include, the temporal life. It's temporal anyway. We can put much emphasis sometimes in our temporal life and in our temporal bodies. You know, even now as we come into more of the Christmas holidays and stuff, sometimes we can get so focused on, you know, putting up the Christmas tree, buying the gifts for this person, that person, making sure that we do our Christmas traditions, singing the Christmas songs, and all these different things. And I'm not saying anything's wrong with any of that, but sometimes we can get so focused on what is happening right now that we forget about the things that truly matter in regards to eternity. We have true life that can be found in Christ that no man can touch. Barnes says this, temporal death is a slight thing compared with eternal death. He directs them, therefore, not to be alarmed at the prospect of temporal death. Look, we grieve death. We should. We mourn. We ought to mourn. These are things that we need to do. Yet for the believer, we have great hope as our life is hidden with Christ. And our life, one day, when Christ is revealed, will be revealed too. I look forward to the day when I can be with Jesus. And I can see my little one. I'm glad that there's eternal. I'm glad that we're more than just a body that can die. There's no one on this earth can touch your life that's hidden with Christ. So with that in mind, I want to close with just three points of application for us today. The first is this, a point that I probably was intending to talk a lot more about than I actually did, but still mean to talk about. That is, don't fear man. Don't be afraid of man. Can they hurt you? Can they do evil against you? Yes. But against what? That which is temporal. Can they kill? Yes, they can kill. But it's all temporal. Don't be afraid of them. Fear God. We're not talking about being afraid of God and need to run away from God. That God is scary. That's not the point, right? The point is that He is holy and great and awesome. And we respect and revere Him because of His awesomeness. And because He's the one who has the power. We'll talk about that more next time I preach. Don't fear man. Fear God. He's the one who has control over the soul. Number two. Trust God with your whole life. I've used that many times as an application. But I really feel it today. Because there's things I don't understand. I have lots of why questions for myself right now that I'm wrestling with. And I don't know that I'm going to get any of those answers this side of heaven. And I'm at a place where I think I'm okay with that. Because I can trust Him. Because He knows why. And His why is a good reason. And I don't know what it is, but I can trust Him with that. We need to trust Him. And that means sometimes we won't know the answers. Sometimes it won't make sense to us, but we can trust that He is good. He is powerful. He has a purpose and He has planned and He's giving meaning to difficult situations. He's working things out for good. Even if you don't see it at the moment. Finally today, I want to close to remind us of the hope that we have. Hope in the life that you have in Christ. very glad that as I grieve, I'm going to continue to grieve, by the way. I'm not done grieving. I'm glad that as I grieve, I can hold on to the hope that I have in Christ. The hope that my child is with him. The hope that I'll see that little one again, see Jesus. It doesn't mean that my grief is diminished in any way. I'm still grieving and I'm still feeling the depths of that. When my mom passed away, a lot of people would come, they would say well-meaning things. They would say things like, you know, don't cry, she's in heaven. You know, and I would think, yeah, I know that's true. She is with the Lord, but I'm still hurting. And that grief is real. I'm so thankful God meets me in the midst of my grief. So we're not diminishing grief and pain and suffering. That's not the goal. But the goal is to say, in the midst of your grief and suffering, you have hope. You have hope. Because God is at work. And he will do what he needs to do. That will ultimately bring honor and glory to him. And will be good for those that love him. We need to live with an eternal perspective today. And I pray and I hope that you would join me as I wrestle with that in my life today. To live and think, to live for the eternal and not the temporal. I'm so glad we have a God who we can hope in today. Would you bow with me in meditation? Father, we come to you today, and I know my heart is heavy. And Lord, I thank you that even in the midst of grief, we can hope in you. Lord, I pray that you would continue to help me, to help us have an eternal mindset, even as we deal with temporal difficulties. Lord, help us to trust you. In Jesus' name we pray. Comparing that momentary light affliction that we go through to the eternal weight of glory and the hope that we have in Christ. Have a great day.